Good morning. Welcome to worship at the Clinton United Methodist Church. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Reverend Jessica Brendler Naulty, and it is a joy to serve here at such a great church where we learn to love God more and learn to love our neighbors more as we serve and are sent for others. We're so glad that you've joined us either in person or online. We invite you to open your heart and spirit and let your faith grow and let your love be made known. So one of the ways we do that is to pass the peace of Christ among the gathered body. If you're joining from home, you're welcome to send a quick text to somebody or shoot an email or just use the opportunity later in the day to call somebody and pass the peace of Christ. Say, hey, peace be with you. But we are here in this space, so I'm going to invite us to greet one another. We are in a CDC COVID medium risk, so some people might be wearing masks. Please be attentive to that. Listen to body language, if you know what I mean. And so just try to be as respectful of others as you possibly can be. Let us pass the peace with words of greeting. Amen. We're all getting the rhythm of this passing the peace thing. It's wonderful. As we return to our seats, let us join our hearts in a spirit of prayer. O God, creator of all we are and know, we gather to worship you this day. You are an awesome God, greater than our comprehension or imagination. You are beyond any word we could ever use to describe you. And yet, through Jesus, we know the intimacy of your great love. We've come to you this day in thanksgiving and praise to know that you are God and to place our lives anew into your hands. Enlarge our vision with your word. Instill in us your hope in place of our despair, your peace where our hatred threatens, your joy amidst our struggle, your love filling us with compassion. May your Holy Spirit surround and inspire us today and all days. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we sing our opening hymn, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds, number 557.
Jessica will be on vacation beginning this afternoon through next Sunday. We are blessed to have Hannah Schendler as our guest speaker next week. Hannah has been on mission at a Lithuanian school and has many updates for us. She is very thankful for the support that this congregation has given her through the years. If you have any pastoral needs throughout the week, you may call the church office for assistance. Are you looking forward to getting to know Pastor Jess? In July and August, she will meet with CUMC teams and small groups. If you're not part of a team or small group, you can join one of our open invitation meetings on Sunday, August 7th at 7 p.m. via Zoom, which is hopefully good for, but not limited to, those of you who worship online with us. And on Sundays, August 14th and 28th, after the service in the church office. An RSVP is required for the open invitation meetings. Please contact the church office by email, office@sentforothers.org, or by phone, 908-735-7025 to register. Kids Camp is one of our major outreach efforts, and the majority of our campers do not attend Clinton UMC. If you'd like to help spread the good news of God's love beyond our four walls, please see me or email me at faith@sentforothers.org to talk about ways to volunteer. We are accepting campers ages 3 through 12, and anyone 13 years and older is welcome to come volunteer at camp. And now for children's time, Miss Mariana and I are going to lead you in a song. If you can stand up, please do so. This is Peace Like a River. I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got joy like a mountain, I've got joy like, I've got joy like in my soul. I've got joy like, I've got joy like, I've got joy like in my soul. I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean in my soul. I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean in my soul. Okay, you can all sit back down. Thank you very much. Gonna wait for Miss Mariana to get to the back before. And now the children can go downstairs. So we can corral them like little fish. Thank you.
I just want to say that's going to be a hard act to follow. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Ryan, so much. Of course. And I apologize to Andrew last week, but I apologize to us all for skipping the special music in that part of the service. I'm still getting used to the order. So I'm assuming that we'll get to hear the piece that was supposed to be last week another day. So thank you. As we move into our time of prayer today, I just want to remind us that in the books that are passed around, there are prayer cards that you can fill out and drop in the offering plate or hand to me or one of the ushers as you exit. You are also always welcome to call the main office or email Sandy with any prayer requests you have that you would like to be shared in that weekly Monday prayer email. We're not going to speak aloud into a microphone our prayer requests, but what we are going to do in the partway through the prayer is I'll pause for a moment of silence, and it won't be silent because we're going to have an opportunity to share aloud together all at the same time any prayers that we have. It can be a name, it can be a situation, a circumstance. So we'll all speak them aloud at the same time, and then I will close that prayer time at the end. So I invite you to join your heart and spirit with mine in an attitude of prayer. Good and gracious God, we come to you in prayer this day with hearts full of both joy and sorrow. We lift prayers of thanksgiving for new life, a new love, a new hope, which is unfolding around us, reminding us that even when all seems dark and cold, your resurrection spirit is stirring us to new life. When we feel weighed down by the struggles and challenges we face each day, or by the overwhelming news of war, oppression, and injustice, help us hold on to your hope, which always springs forth in time. We pray for the nations of our world and their leaders, that they might lead with wisdom and courage and love for all your beloved children. May they be guided to lead toward peace and reconciliation, even and especially where war rages. We lift prayers for those who are sick, whether in body, mind, or spirit, that they may find healing and be restored to wholeness. And if physical healing does not come as we hope, we pray for those who grieve, that they may know the comfort of your spirit in the face of loss. We pray for our neighbors who do not know where their next meal will come from, and those who do not know where they will sleep tonight. May they receive sustenance and rest in the form of compassionate hands who feed and clothe and shelter, and also in the form of courageous hearts and minds who seek a way to a future in which everyone has all they need. May we faithfully serve all our neighbors with care and compassion, extending God's grace to all. And now we pause for a time to lift our personal prayers to you, trusting that you hear both words spoken aloud and in the silence of our hearts. So we pause now to speak aloud the prayers that are on our hearts. God, we trust that you hear the prayers we speak and those we speak in our hearts. Even when we don't hear or see the answer to prayer that we are hoping for. Help us trust that you are surely at work in our lives and in the world around us. Give us courage and strength and your abundant love overflowing so that all we do, we may do in trust of you and in love for others. In your holy name we pray, amen. And now we lift our voices together to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The reading for this morning comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 through 27. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with great honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Over the past 2 weeks, we have been reflecting on the invitation that God extends to each of us. And the invitation, it's to come and to drink deeply of the life-giving waters, to grow through a relationship with God and a community of faith. And then how that invitation impacts how we live and interact in the world around us, both in the church and in our everyday lives. We pushed our contemporary understanding of hospitality to a deeper level. And we were challenged to apply it to our lives. We celebrate the gracious welcome of God for all. But today, we're going to pause for a little reality check. If all are welcome, if all are invited, that means all may come. That all people, those who look, think, and act differently than us, are invited as well. And we all know that when people with different ideologies, theologies, politics, and life experiences come together, it adds a level of complexity and often challenge to a community dynamic. You can just look at the news and the politics and Facebook nowadays and know that we really struggle with diversity. We struggle when people see the world in a different way than we do. We love conformity. In particular, we love conformity to our standards, what we have decided is right and wrong. In other words, we want other people to behave like us, to believe like us, to be like us. This is particularly true in the church. After all, we're supposed to be one big happy family, right? Yes. But if we're all family, should we all behave the same way, believe the same way, and agree to everything? That happens in your families, right? No. Because we're real. We're human. We think different things. We believe different things. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, the Apostle Paul deals with the problem of unity amidst diversity. Paul does not say that unity demands conformity. He does not say that all Christians should look alike, think alike, live alike. Paul is speaking to a very active church. There was a lot of vitality in Corinth. There were many people exercising a variety of gifts. One gift in particular, though, was causing trouble. The gift of speaking in tongues. Some people then, as now, made speaking of unknown or spiritual languages the criteria for a faithful Christian. They wanted to limit the church to tongue speakers only. That was the proof of faith. They wanted conformity. But what Paul gave them was a lesson in theology. We are the body of Christ. The Holy Spirit makes us that through our baptism and through our community. For by one Spirit, we are all one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all are made to drink of the one Spirit. Paul means that, yes, indeed, there is unity in the church. We are the body of Christ. There is one Spirit that binds us together, making us one in Christ. But unity does not equal conformity. Paul says, as the body is one and has many members, and all the members being the body, and all the members of the body being many are one body, so also is Christ. We are one body with many parts, with different functions, different purposes, bringing different gifts. Paul goes on to point out that the eye and the ear and the hand all need each other. I'm going to say that again. They all need each other to make one body. They may not do the same things, but put them together and they make a rather nice body, one that can see and hear and taste and smell, reach and stand, walk and talk. And so it is, says Paul, with the church. We do not all have the same gifts. We do not all speak in tongues or prophesy or teach. We do not all believe the same way and live the same way. The Spirit has given us each gifts according to God's wisdom. Put them all together and you have a church, the body of Christ. There can be unity amidst diversity. In fact, that's exactly how God works. We need to hear Paul's word to the Corinthians, especially as United Methodists in such a time as this. Folks, we are part of a denomination that has been in conflict over our stance on human sexuality for more than 50 years. Our general conference sessions have been battlegrounds for the words in our book of discipline regarding same-gender marriage and ordination of LGBTQ individuals. It is apparent to anyone looking in from the outside that we do not agree. But when legislation was proposed to add that simple statement to the book of discipline, we do not all agree, it was voted down 51% to 49%. That right there tells you how much we don't agree. How divided we are. The more conservative group, once called the Good News Movement, and then the Wesleyan Covenant Association, after trying to lead the denomination into a more traditional stance with punitive policies, policies that would punish and defrock clergy for performing same-gender weddings, or bishops for ordaining LGBTQ+ clergy. But after finding resistance, great resistance, and flat-out ignoring of the punitive aspects that were added to the Book of Discipline in 2019, this group decided to break off from the United Methodist Church and create a new denomination called the Global Methodist Church. And that's underway as we speak. They're still forming and churches are still having the option, clergy are still having the option to break away. Here in our Clinton United Methodist Church, we've begun the conversation around whether we are welcoming and fully inclusive of our LGBTQ+ siblings. The results of our straw poll indicated that 3/4 would be ready to make a public statement of inclusive welcome, but 1/4 are still on the fence. Either don't believe we need to, or don't believe we should. Folks, we come to worship each week with people who believe differently than us. We have here at this church not only a variety of gifts, but a variety of theologies and interpretations of what it looks like to faithfully live out the gospel message. Some more progressive, some more traditional. Some days our differences may seem more glaring than others, especially when current events, either in the world or in the church, fuel the fires of our conviction. But Paul encourages us to see our differences as a gift rather than a defect, to rely on Christ's love and the Spirit's uniting presence to bind us together, to learn from one another, to love one another, and to function together as the body of Christ. If we allow the church to become a battleground, fighting amongst ourselves, it will never be what the Spirit has called us to be. if we allow the desire to win fuel our faith life, we face two choices. First, we can use our interpretation of Scripture like a weapon and beat each other into conformity. We can fight and scratch and claw until the stronger group wins and the losers just hang around, their gifts neglected and their anger burning. The second option, if we let the desire to win take control, the second option draws on Paul's image. We can amputate. Perhaps the body doesn't really need the nose or the hand or the ear. Maybe the body should just be one big mouth. And everyone else should take their marbles and go play elsewhere. Just as the body has many parts and works together to accomplish amazing things. Folks, God calls us together with all our diversity so that we can use our unique and varied gifts to build up the body of Christ, to serve others. God empowers us to accomplish more together than we ever could apart. Disagreements should not stop us from being the church together. We're called to find a way to honor the different perspectives we bring to the table and to be enriched by a diversity of thought. Let us remember that the early church did not all agree either, but they still hung together and they lived out their faith as the body of Christ. People did not say of the early church, "Look how they all agree." No, they said, "Look how they all love each other." I think this is the hardest part of fully living out God's radical invitation and saying, "All are welcome." Because if you really mean it, then you will undoubtedly have dissension. Everyone will not agree. And Paul tells us that's okay. Difference and diversity, while they bring challenges to a community, also bring blessings. As Paul reminded the church in Corinth, different people bring different gifts to be shared in the body of Christ. And not only are all welcome, but all are needed. All are needed, folks. Will we step on each other's toes as we dance together? Undoubtedly, yes. Will there be hurt feelings? Probably. Part of being a family, right? But we love each other and forgive each other and apologize when hurt and harm happen, and we strive to do better next time. We will learn and grow, learn more about God and ourselves and the amazing and beautiful diversity that God has made in the world around us. We will be stretched and challenged, growing together from our diversity rather than being closed off by it. Responding to our differences in Christian love means giving up competing with each other, looking for the winner and the loser. Love, God's love, calls us to accept our diversity, to know and profit from each other's gifts. Love calls us to talk with each other when we disagree, not just unfriend people, and to listen when we are disagreed with. Sometimes it calls us to compromise for the good of the other. We are the body of Christ, individuals united by the one Spirit. I pray that we may truly reach out to all God's people, extending God's invitation to come. Drink deeply of the water that refreshes and renews. Experiencing the blessings and challenges of a diverse community where we may grow together and serve side by side, doing God's work of kingdom building in our midst. May it be so. Amen. In a spirit of response, I invite us to stand in body or in spirit and sing together, "Together We Serve." It's number 2175.
Will the ushers please come forward for the giving of our tithes and offerings? Thank you. Lord, we offer these gifts to you with thankful hearts and in joyous praise. May this offering extend the work of your kingdom in our church, our community, and into the beautiful world which you have made. Amen.
Morning, all. This song is it's called Smile, and I identify well with this one because the first line of the chorus is, there's always a reason to always choose joy. And I think that there's a lot to be said for that, to just decide to be a happy person. It's worked well for me. Ready?
Lost your way, lost your cool, straight up lost your mind. Try so hard to stay ahead, keep falling behind. Life is gonna pull you down, make it hard to see. A little change in your point of view could be just what you need. There's always a reason to always choose joy. There's something deeper that the world can't destroy. Smile when you think you can't. Smile, get up and dance. Smile, there's a bigger plan. The storm only lasts for a while. So smile. Happiness is wonderful, doesn't stick around. Walk in our sunshine, here come the clouds. You can laugh, you can cry when it all falls apart. I believe the more you laugh, the more you heal the heart. There's always a reason to always choose joy. There's something deeper that the world can't destroy. Smile when you think you can't. Smile, get up and dance. Smile, there's a bigger plan. You've got a reason to smile when you think you can't. Smile, just clap your hands. Smile, there's a bigger plan. You've got a reason to smile.
What a wonderful song to close this sermon series, this 3 weeks focus on welcome with, because the joy of the Lord comes from that invitation to come as we are and to extend that joyful welcome for all. So as we go into our week, no matter where you're going to, I know I'm running out to go catch a ferry. Woo. Wherever you are going this week, this day, may the joy of the Lord go with you, fill you, bubble up within you, and overflow so that all may experience the gracious welcome of God, the love of God pouring forth from God to you and to you from you to others. Let us go to love and to serve. Amen. Amen.
Yeah, there's always a reason to always choose. choose joy. There's something deeper than the world can destroy. Smile when you think.